Hello everybody, and welcome to the next part of my gaming history. I know the previous video was a lot about racing games, while actually platform games, adventure games and shooting games were better. One of my favorite platform games was this one, Pac-Land from Namco. Well, at least the original was from Namco. I don't know who developed it for the Commodore 64. But they actually captured the feel and the gameplay of the arcade version quite good. It was responsive, colorful, and well, that's what it was. That's what it's all about. But back in the time, games were also difficult. So, as you can see, the first and second part from this game, the graphics are, for that time, very nice. And I had a great time playing them. It started out quite easy, avoiding the things and the enemies. Remembering the patterns really help with games like that. And so, it's time to show you a different game. I sometimes may be in the way of the screen because this is just immediately taken from my PC. I've started up a few games, and here's the second one. Ghost and Goblins on the Commodore 64. This was actually really my favorite game. It was very difficult. But boy, I really loved the graphics and the music. Well, let's see if there is... Yes! Nice! Listening to this brings me back in the time when I played this game so much. It was very difficult, and that was actually a terrible pickup, to be honest, because there's only one weapon you want to have, and that's the knife. And if you have the knife, you can play this game around for the second time, and then you pick up a different weapon with which to destroy the dragon at the end of the game. Those basket carriers, yes, there it is, the knife. For me, the only weapon of use. I know the Commodore 64 version is shorter than the arcade version. I think it has to do with the lack of memory because, well, 64K isn't much and it's a single file load game. So it's loading it in and then you can play from start to finish without interruption of loading times. So I preferred that compared to multi-load games, especially back in the time. And on the arcade, I was not good enough to get very far. And that meant, well, I never even get to see the original stage that is supposed to be missing. So, well, other than that, this still has that arcadey feeling. Of course, this is a bit more easy compared to the arcade version. But still, quite a challenge. Back in the time, not only your amount of lives were getting in your way, but as you can see, also a time difference. So you have to actually quite step on it and you cannot linger around trying to pick up every bonus in the game. And despite back in the time, attack patterns were very easy. As you can see, the end boss was just jumping towards you. And that's quite easy to avoid. But on several stages, you are being attacked while you avoiding the end of level boss. And despite the Commodore 64 only having 16 colors, you still get many different backgrounds, and well, for me that was awesome to see that they get this out of a computer of these technical specifications. Too bad back in the time I wasn't rich enough to get all the old school games, because I also have a lot of YouTube friends preferring the Spectrum. Well, back in the time I never played on the Spectrum, but judging from the videos from my friends, they are very happy with the gameplay. Some games look a tad faster than the Commodore 64 versions. Some also look less difficult, so more playable. Ooh, that was quite difficult. But this is already the final stage on the Commodore 64. After this hill, there's like a huge drop down, and there's the final door. You get to fight the snake, and that's the end of the game. So yes, it's actually quite short compared to the arcade. But like I said, I never got far in that game, and I actually always wanted to be able to finish a game with the use of just one credit. So I actually had to start her over again and again. I've got myself a few nice real arcade versions. Also on the Xbox 360, I've got the Namco collections with the old games, with the shooting game, that 1942 or something like that, with a old airplane is shooting. And there's also Ghost and Goblins in there. And that's very bad. Very bad, I mean. That's very difficult. And as you can see, Mounty Mall was playing this. Thanks. So there's a bit of a commercial for his website. And there's the other game that I really liked and have great. Why are you going away? Thank you. So here's another one. This has nice music as well. I will turn it back on and show you a little bit of the music and gameplay of Hades Nebula. I don't know if I pronounce this properly, because I'm not from England or America. English isn't my main language, but and I hear this, the tune is immediately stuck in my head. It was very repetitive, but I really like those sounds. And then that like the drums. And it keeps on repeating, but then with adding and removing some sound effects, it really gave the game its own feel with the nice song. And well, back in the time, racing games were very bad on the Commodore 64. I didn't have one single game that I liked better than shooters like this or the platform games. Because, well, platform games were more suited for the Commodore 64. Or top-down shooters like this, or for instance, I don't have it in this selection, but if you go look for Commando, that was one of my favorite games also on this computer. Well, I have so many favorite games, but there are games that I just played so much. And then when I have been selecting some videos to search, to show you, then it was like, what am I gonna show? Well, and sometimes there's a bit of music that I want to show you. Sometimes some stages, as you can see, there's some kind of a parallax effect going on with the background scrolling down and the stars standing still. Yes, there were some games, let's turn down the music, there were some games that actually made good use of the graphical capabilities of the Commodore 64. And there was a certain time they actually created something like a shoot 'em up construction kit set. I didn't search a video for that, but oh, that's a nice upgrade. With those blades you can destroy enemies which are touching the blades. But, well, the one playing, because it's not me, I just searched for some games on YouTube to talk about and relive my gaming past. Because, well, I got my Commodore 64, but it's hooked up to a tube television. If I would record from that, there wouldn't be such nice graphics. And this camera picks up the image much better from an LCD TV. I also tried recording from my LED television, the 3D LED television, but that also didn't give me a satisfying result. And the capture card that I use only works with the Wii U, the Xbox 360, and the Xbox One. So I couldn't capture this video from that console. So this was the only way to give you a bit of an image while I am talking about my game history. So let's go on to the next one. This is a nice game. It's nice to see it back. And there's another one from Sega, Zaxxon. That was also top down, but it's due to the different way of drawing, it gave you a feeling of 3D depth. There's a mirror on the left side on your screen, and then you can see how low your plane is to the ground, or how close your plane is to the ground. And so you can estimate how far you must go up or down to hit the enemies and shoot down those circular tanks, because they give your plane some much needed fuel, because later in the game you really need it, because your fuel is going to be used up quite fast. And that's a power field. Well, also for this time, the graphics weren't bad, the animation, the explosions, and let's see how the sounds, because I kind of forgot how that sounded like. Okay, I kind of forget, there's no music, just some sound. Yeah, nice to hear that back, but to be honest, I never played the arcade, and I knew this was an arcade conversion. I don't know, back in the time, I actually, to be honest, even not now, know how close this is to the arcade version. But it's a great game, and I really like the perspective, the 3D perspective, and the drawing. And it also looks like they seem to have more fine lines in drawing, for instance, the bricks in the wall. If I look to the game like that, the first game that started this video, the Pac-Land, that had very thick lines, and this looks more of a higher resolution, even though the Commodore 64, didn't have such a high resolution. It was quite blocky. It's a nice game, it's a bit slow paced, but well, that was fine by me, because then finally I could get a little bit further in that game. Okay, on to the next one. This was a difficult game, but I loved the music. Let's see if I can turn it on. And there we go. Oh, there's a commercial there. I forgot that if you start playing, the sound effects are ruining the song. So let's turn it off. This was a game. This is not me playing. I think this player knows how this game works. Me, I never actually understand this game at all. And so I never could get far. Still, I loaded up the game quite often. And you know why? I just left it demoing, listening to the music. It was so happy. Yes, I still got the bass line stuck in my head. It was just awesome. But let's stop over here. It was really strange that well, thing on the spring, it really lives up to its name. It's just a thing on the spring, and that's all you get. I didn't get the surroundings and how it worked. And this was graphically an amazing game. Yes, it's also isometric. And to be honest, in the beginning when I bought this game, I was kind of disappointed that the screen didn't follow your fighter, that you are just walking in and out of a screen and you get a new screen. But well, after you got over the disappointment and you get deeper in the game, it was actually a very nice game. And let's listen to the sound effects. Yes, that's quite difficult. I know the collision detection is a bit off there, but if your jumping was failing, your ninja couldn't swim. That's strange. It's nice to see how when you enter a new part of the screen, you get to see it all built up. It's almost like pop-up in a current game when there's not much polygons to be drawn, and then you can see all into the distance. So this, to me, it feels like they builded separate sprites, and with that they constructed the backgrounds instead of it being just a drawing where you walk over it. And that's why if I would have walked left through the gateway, you actually see him pass those posts from the entrance of the building. As you can see, that the bird just flew through the gate, and that's why it has that 3D effect, that your character could be in front of or behind a sprite. And that's why you get to see that strange pop-up effect. But back in the time, it had its charm. Okay, the first racing game. And this is on the Amiga. We are leaving the Commodore 64 times. I had an Amiga 500 with the extra memory, because I also had a painting program with which I could animate. Listen to the music of the Amiga. Compared to the Commodore 64, this was so much better. The Amiga really was a jump up in graphics and sound. But too bad with this game, it was either you get racing sounds and bump effects, or you have music. This gamer preferred... Oh, it was the demonstration. I thought it was someone's playing, but... Well, when you start the game, you have to choose between the music or the sound effects. The most important thing from this game, there was first Lotus Esprit Turbo Challenge, and that was a split screen game. Even if you are playing a single player version mode in that game, you had split screen, and then the bottom driver was some computer AI controlled guy. Or no, if my memory serves me well, you got to see a car standing in a garage or something. Anyway, no matter how it worked, you had a split screen like this also in the single player mode. And with this game, and that's why this is my favorite racing game on the Amiga, with this game, if you play a single player game, you had full screen. Let me see if I can skip to some gameplay. Yes, there we are. And as you can see, full screen, and for its time, really smooth and fast scrolling. Let's see what this gamer chose to do. The racing effects, and listen to the countdown of your timer. A woodblock. Checkpoint. Yes. So, when I saw this game, it was like, wow, I wish they did Outrun for this system. Look at the magnificent graphics, the speedy, the scrolling. It was amazing. And despite it wasn't actually sprite scaling, I was kind of fooled into thinking it was, because it's so smooth. And yes, these creators really knew how to harness the power of the Amiga. They had some great designers getting the mimicking, the smooth enlarging, the scaling effects on the sprites. So, don't be disappointed. But now, I know this video wouldn't be about too much racing games, and if my memory serves me well, Outrun is the only one that I'm going to show as a racing game, but to show you the difference between them. And well, in the previous video with the racing games, I actually didn't mention the Amiga. While the Amiga had some great games like this, And then there's this Outrun on the Amiga. I skipped the let's start it up. I skipped the intro because that's bombastic and you get to see an arcade perfect picture, maybe even better looking than the arcade. And I was like, wow, this can't be true. And you know what? I was right. It wasn't true. That was not how the game looked. As you can see, the scrolling is so slow and so shocking. I can't believe that the developers of this game were playtesting and think, yeah, this is nice, we can release this. They don't see the difference between this and Lotus, do they? Well, maybe Lotus was a newer game, but well, I had this one myself. I had this one later as Lotus, and that was a good thing for the Amiga, because otherwise I would have been very disappointed if this was my first racing experience on the Amiga. And then I wouldn't have no trust in that it actually can do racing games. This is so bad, it's... never mind. And that's why we are going to skip this nightmare. I mean, why is my PC acting up? What happens? Oh. Hello? I think we're having a problem here. Ah! Thank you. Let's shut down. This is still on the Amiga 500. I don't know, my PC don't feel wonderful tonight. This is Dynamite Dux from Sega. Let's see if we can get some moving videos without having some problems. Yes, judging by the time bar, it runs. And also, for the Amiga, I know the platform games or fighting games like this, funny fighting games, very strange enemies like dog faces that skip on nothing more than their necks, to be precise. And well, this duck has a little bit of a look like Rayman. The only fact is that he has arms and he has legs. Yes, this was a funny game. I really liked playing it back in the time, even though it was quite difficult to finish for me. But the funny graphics, very cartoonish, and the weapon pickups like the bombs, as you can see here. Boom! Thank you! Nice. And of course, fast food is not lethal. It doesn't kill you. It makes your power grow. Don't believe the hype. Okay, let's see if we can get it. And now you get some more fast food. And so we die. But, and that was actually very nice, you don't die and then go back to a checkpoint, but you just go on where you left off. And that's actually a good thing. Let's see what sound we have here. Yes, in this case it was also or music or sound effects. You can't have both at the same time. So, let's skip this. Okay, now we're going to 3D on the PlayStation 1. Tomb Raider. Look, adventure games are so nice. And this was the very first time that a game could make me jump up and shock. Oh, I see that my camera seems to be not picking it up really in the middle. But it's amazing that, let's turn on the sound. There's no music, but look, those eerie sounds setting the mood. And here there's a little secret here, and then you jump into that cave there, and then you get some nice extra power. Look, when you see this now, it's quite square-ish. There's not much detail in the background. But this was the first adventure game on the PlayStation that really made an impression of being in a large world that you have to explore, and in this case I can keep the sound up because then you hear a bit of the atmosphere, the running sound. And of course there are enemies, and well, you cannot actually see this on screen right now, but with the auto aim telling me there's an enemy, and in this case it was a black bat. It's like Batman. Yes, you hear it squawking and you see it laying on the floor. That was the first enemy you encounter. So I thought, this game isn't going to be scary or difficult. Well, let me tell you, I will not show you in this video because it will take much too long getting there. But there is a level in a kind of a pyramid or something. And then you hear in the background, goom, goom, goom. And then it was quiet again. And then it came back, goom. I was like, man, what's going to happen? And then suddenly, silent. No more. And then when I threw a switch and I entered the door, there was a dinosaur biting. Ooh, even this sound is scary. Yes, the mood, even now, the mood is set by the music and the eerie atmosphere of the game. And even though there are not much enemies, the ones that are there are impressive, like the wolves. There's a big dinosaur, the first one you encounter in level 2, that's quite close to this one. And playing this game made me feel like a traveler, an explorer myself. And this was actually, for me, I really love the Indiana Jones movies. I also did a movie review on them. And Indiana Jones really was a great movie. And this is the female version of Indiana Jones. Yes, and then I can go to the left. Oh, I didn't know you could do that. But I usually entered on the left and then I got onto this bridge, onto the next part of this level. And the puzzles in this game, they start quite simple and they end on being more difficult. Down there is a bear, if my memory serves me well. I don't know if this player is going to shoot it. Well, he thinks it's better to go to the bear. I was staying on top of there and then shooting it. Yes, I can hear some more bats. Also nice, well, it's not realistic, but a nice fact is that the bullets in her guns, they never run out. You can pick up different weapons, they do run out. And there we are, back where we came from. I never knew you could enter the bridge this way. I always went to the left and then climbed up the wall. But, well, it looks like this is faster. Okay, now he jumps up and then I think he go on. Because you just need to go to the other side. And there's the first save crystal. Which he skips. And there are the first wolves. And on the left side there's a health package. Yes, there it is. Yes, well, I can keep on continue to watch this video. So this was for me. Now the music starts to grow when you encounter the wolves. Let's listen to that. And then I'll skip to the next video. So music, as you can hear, is interactive. Yes, in here there's a little secret as well. The music is interactive, but it doesn't stop immediately if the danger is gone. But the nice thing is the game warns you when there's danger, in other words, enemies in the vicinity. And that made also my heart go up like what, it was really amazing for its time. But when we are going for the more modern adventure games, you'll see it's not that amazing anymore. Well, we are still in the games on the PlayStation, and this was the first platform game that I really liked on the system, Crash Bandicoot. So much lives to be had. I know this wasn't as 3D as Mario 64, but I love the graphics even more than Mario because of it's even more colorful. And well, actually, this game is less confusing. That doesn't mean that I don't like Mario. As a matter of fact, from all the 3D platform games, Mario's the best, because I don't rate this as a 3D platform game. Yes, it's drawn with polygons, but there's totally no freedom in movement, except you can go a bit to the left and to the right. But that was already on the Mega Drive or the Super Nintendo, that you have a little bit more freedom in some games. But the way they draw it, and there's in this way, there's not much pop-up. Oh, that's nice to see how he did that. He's going to pick up the extra apples as well, because he was already at the end of the level. Some say, and that this is quite a difficult game, but well, from all the games that I played, this is, for me, it was actually kind of an easy game. But later in this video, you get to see more games from this creator, Naughty Dog, because they are really amazing. Graphically, they pushed the most out of the PlayStation 1. For me, Crash Bandicoot 3, that was amazing. Freedom on a jet scooter on a kind of a lake. Crash Bandicoot had the greatest graphics for me on that system. On to the next, because when you say platform games, you don't get them better than Mario 64. And well, in this video you actually see quite sharp image quality, and I think he has a great capture device, because as I said before, I'm not playing myself, I just picked up some videos on YouTube, typing in the names of the games that I wanted to show, and this was the result. And I think he did a great job capturing the detail in this game. Because when I had it connect to a tube television back in the time, it was never as sharp as this. It was the Nintendo 64 was famous for its blurry graphics, and this just looks quite sharp. But more important is the gameplay. And with this game, just like with Crash Bandicoot, I wanted to have it perfect. All the stars, I did that. I finished the complete game, and well, I had a great time doing it. And to be honest, after this game, there was not a single platform game in 3D that gave me the feeling, that urge to finish and see it all. Some games, yes, even with the Mario games, they are nice, they are great. But this was actually the first step in 3D, and it still plays perfectly, and that's my hats off to Miyamoto and his team. That was just awesome. Yes, one star, well deserved, for Mario 64. And look at that water effect in the background. 98 stars, and there are 99, so maybe this player didn't collect the star on the roof of the castle where you could meet up with Yoshi. And there's also, oh, maybe he's going to meet the star from, ah, he missed. If you grab the bunny, oh, he already has all the stars here. And the only limitation on this game was, to be honest, the levels weren't actually that huge. They had quite a close up borders. But remember, this is the very first 3D game, and as you can see, there's also secret walls where you can dive through. And before you've seen it all, you have plenty of playing time in this game. And levels like this one that he enters now, they change when you reach some switch. You can lower the level of your water, making some things out of reach, and then you can reach some new things. So for me, the best platform game ever on any Nintendo system. And this was the first shooter that this is the YouTube channel of gameplay trailers, it says in the video. I'm not making a secret about it. It's nice to be able to show and tell instead of just tell, and then you see my face and I'm so happy talking about the games, but it's much more nice to actually see them. The fun and the great thing of this game, I was like, what you can see, you can shoot off his head and you were very precise with the weapon. Of course, the people still look very polygonal, but other than that, this is just amazing. I love the single player. I never finished it completely. I was quite far in the game. But that sneaky feeling and that James Bond mood, it was all there. Yes, and well, I never had two controllers, so I never have experienced the multiplayer mode with friends. But when I see the videos and hear people talking about it, that seemed to be the best way to experience this game. And me, I already had a lot of fun with this without playing this in multiplayer mode. But this was the first game, except for Tomb Raider of course, that making me feel like I am the character running around. And this being first person perspective instead of third person like with Tomb Raider. That's strange. You are walking towards him. He would have heard your footsteps, but they don't respond. This player knows exactly, judging by his playing, where the enemies are. As soon as they are there, he shoots and they are dead. Me, I died along the way. I know he's got to go through some kind of an airlock. This game I bought after reading the review in The Edge, and they are right, the graphics are great. This player doesn't show it, but oh, as you can see, bullets strike the surroundings and then you get to see a hole. Back in the time, such details really made the game. He was just waiting for that guy coming out of that door. The AI was actually a bit stupid when you see it like this, but well, what can I say? I mean, we are spoiled nowadays with the graphics and the games from now. But when I was yesterday, I was watching a movie, a kind of a documentary about the history of gaming, and I thought, you know what? I want to do a history of my games, the experience that I had, and this is then part two of it. I don't know if you've watched part one. If you like it, you can. If you didn't and you like it, you can do that still. But well, this game was for me also sorry, a huge game changer in giving the player the feeling that he's actually inside a James Bond movie, getting rid of the bad guys. Nice. Okay, there's just two more games to go, and they are both from the same developer, Naughty Dog, the creator of Crash Bandicoot made this. This is on the PlayStation 3. And well, when I look at these, the animation, the graphics, even look at the detail at his fingers, not much polygon going on, everything looks rounded, circular. And there's also a scene in this game where he and a girl are laying on the bed and she is walking with her fingers over his body. The developers of Naughty Dog, they actually pay attention to the collision detection from where the hand's supposed to go. You don't get to see much problems like polygons going through each other. I know you can still get a gun and then you walk up to a wall and then the gun disappears into the door or wall, but mostly this game is all about the details. And despite I know the when it came to the games made by developers developing for both the PlayStation 3 and the Xbox 360, usually it was the 360 version that was graphically the best. But when you give a proper developer the proper tools and or they develop the tools themselves, then you get games like this. When I see this back, actually, and then this is a rendered video, live it even better to look at. And then I think, what is the difference between this and the PlayStation 4? Because next to this, there's a game that's already also out on the PlayStation 3 and 4, and that's The Last of Us. And that is better. You can't expect better graphics than that. To me, Naughty Dog are the king in graphics and in animation. You really live through this adventure. And it was like, oh, I hope the train doesn't break. And then, yes, the pipe bends. So much detail. The first time that I lived through this part, it was like, oh, you were so excited. And that's what I want from an adventure game. That you feel nervous yourself by, oh, maybe I'm gonna fall and I crash to my death. Yes, and games like this reminds me why I still game even though I am an adult for quite a long time. Back in the time when gamers were still looked upon as nerds and nobody actually understand why we're playing games. And now that the gaming is more, yeah, a lot of people accept that gaming is also a nice way to entertain yourself. Because, well, look at this. It's like you are living movie moments, but now you are in control. You are that main character. And to me, I live moments, tension moments in games. I live much more, I'm not English, it's difficult to find the proper words, but it's more exciting to live those moments while you are in control than watching a movie, seeing an actor going through the paces. He has to escape, for instance, or whatever movie I'm talking about, it doesn't matter. An action movie like this, this is more exciting because it's up to you if the character makes it or not. And of course, with the graphics of nowadays, it helps that it leaves little to your imagination because everything is there. Wow, this moment I will never forget. This was like, ooh. Well, I didn't select the game. I actually should have also shown you some videos from one of my favorite shooters on the Xbox 360, and that's Gears of War. In one, the graphics were amazing and brutal with the chainsaw sawing the enemies in half. But in part 2 and part 3, with much improved animation, it was even more awesome. And this game, everything is perfect. Everything is so superly sharp drawn. Actually, this looks like next gen, but then there's a camera point of view over this area, and then you get to see those birthday flags, those triangle shaped flags, and they are not moving, as if there's no wind, but in the background you just saw the grass moving. I was just paying attention to that. You see the grass swaying in the wind. You can see the roof here. Oh, now my fingers are in the way, but the plants are moving. And then there's a time they show you those flags, those birthday-like flags. I don't know, they use it for decoration in here. And they are not moving at all. And that was like, this game is so full of details. How could they have looked over that and think, that looks realistic? But now I'm nitpicking, because the rest of this game is so brilliant. And still, it's too bad they don't do games on Microsoft console, but well, actually Sony also of course has to have its exclusives, otherwise there's no reason to stay on one console. No exclusives means that everybody can just buy whatever console they want, because all the games will be on there. Yes, nice story. The animation is already awesome. Also the talking when you... Oh, let's give it a bit of sound.
Sounds like you're working for a nutcase. Some collector who's got too much time and money on his hands. And by the way, this is not worth any of it.
But there's more. How's your 13th century Latin, mate?
Where'd you get this?
Ah, did you see the birthday flags? They weren't moving at all. But enough nitpicking. On to one of their finest moments in gaming history. I picked the PlayStation 4 version. But this is equally impressive on the PlayStation 3. And as a matter of fact, when it comes to polygonal shapes, I don't see much difference in this and the PlayStation 3 version. This video is brought to you by Rajman Gaming HD. Thank you. And well, as you can see, the animation, and let's listen to them talk.
What are you still doing that? It's late.
God, what time is it?
It's way past your bedtime.
But it's still today.
Honey, please not right now. I do not have the energy for this.
Here.
What's this?
Your birthday?
Ha, oh, that's so nice.
As you can see,
the detail on his clothing, the bumps and the fuzzy thing that sticks out when a t-shirt is worn out a bit. The animation is so great, and well, as you can see in the history of gaming, in my history, all the games that I owned, there's so much progress. And well, and that's also immediately the answer in what people could ask themselves: why do people game? Well, this is like watching a movie, but you are the actor and you decide if the story fails or succeeds, because if you're not a good player, you won't finish the movie, and so the story is bad. Well, bad, it ends bad, because it won't end for them. So I hope you liked the movie. It was a little bit of a going through the paces, through the old games, the newer games, and when I look back, I'm glad that I seen all kinds of games from old to new. I still like to play the old games sometimes. Just when you play them, you really appreciate what you have now. Because right now, when I listen to other gamers or big YouTube channels, when they do a review on games like this, and then it's like, this is bad, that is bad. Well, actually, I did it also a little bit with the nitpicking about the waving flags in the previous game with Nathan Drake. But, well, to be honest, when you play those old games and then you go back to these new games, you appreciate how much gaming graphics and the gaming controls have been progressing from okay to super. It's amazing that you can actually be a race driver, you can be a little girl, you are going through the motions and relive those movie moments. So I hope you liked the videos, and well, maybe I do some more games that I have, of course, from old to new. That all depends on how much response I get from the two videos that I did yesterday and today. I will upload them, one of them I will upload today, and this one will be the day after. Okay, see you.